If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice at the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains,
this is the year that we this is the year.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Lord, we love you, Lord. It's a blessing to be in your house today, Lord, where we don't have to worry about being persecuted, Lord. All the stuff going around the world. Lord, we just thank you. We just ask that you bless this offering this morning, Lord. Use it in your kingdom as you see fit, Lord. We love you and praise your name. Amen.
Amen. If you could, stay standing and open in your Bibles to Luke, the 18th chapter. We want to give a big welcome to everyone joining us now on Facebook Live. We apologize for the delay in the live feed this morning. Luke chapter 18, verses 1 through 14. Title of this message is The Way to Pray. He then told them a parable on the need for them to pray always and not become discouraged. There was a judge in a certain town who didn't fear God or respect man. And a widow in that town kept coming to him, saying, "Give me justice against my adversary." For a while he was unwilling, but later he said to himself, "Even though I don't fear God or respect man, yet because this widow keeps pestering me, I will give her justice, so she doesn't wear me out by her persistent coming." Then the Lord said, "Listen to what the unjust says. Will not God grant justice to his elect who cry out to him day and night? Will he delay to help them? I tell you that he will swiftly grant them justice. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth?" He also told him this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and looked down on everyone else. Two men went up to the temple complex to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee took his stand and was praying like this: "God, I thank you that I'm not like other people, greedy, unrighteous, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of everything I get." But the tax collector, who was standing far off, kept striking his chest and saying, "God, turn your wrath from me, a sinner. I tell you that this one went down to his house justified rather than the other. Because everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but whoever humbles himself will be exalted." Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We praise you, Lord, that you humbled yourself, taking on the form of a servant, and gave your life for us. Help us, O Lord, as we seek to follow you and obey your will. Lord, show us the way to pray and help us to follow in it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You can be seated. Now, Jesus has been teaching his disciples about having real faith for real life. And he's teaching those now who are looking for the kingdom, those who are following him and looking for the kingdom. And he's going to show them the way to pray. Now, this is a key lesson for everyone. And here, Jesus has a very specific reason for teaching this lesson. And we see that in verse number 1, we are told to pray always. And we are familiar with that. We know the verse. The Bible says, pray without ceasing, or pray continually. We're told to be steadfast and constant in prayer. And all prayer is talking to God, communicating with God. Prayer is the way that we communicate with God. He speaks to us, and we speak to him in prayer. Prayer is the spiritual oxygen for the believer. It is vital to our spiritual life. And without prayer, we have no relationship with God. Leonard Ravenhill said it this way: no one is greater than their prayer life. Doesn't matter how gifted you are, doesn't matter how rich you are, doesn't matter how long you've been coming to church, doesn't matter what your position in the church is, no one is greater than their prayer life. It is the highest honor and highest calling and privilege in the universe. Elizabeth Elliot said this: prayer lays hold of God's plan and becomes the link between his will and its accomplishment on the earth. Amazing things happen, and we are given the privilege of being channels for the Holy Spirit's prayer. Prayer is not bound by time or by lifetime. Did you know that even after you pass away and go on to be in heaven with the Lord Jesus, if you're a Christian, God continues to answer your prayers? I know that God is answering prayers right now, this very moment, that my grandmother prayed for me. So prayer is not bound by time or by a lifetime. Prayer is the highest calling. And so we kind of know that. I don't think any Christian in this room today is surprised by the fact that Jesus told you to pray. Is that a shock to anybody? We're like, okay, duh. We got that. But here's the second part. And the second part is the key: to pray always and not become discouraged. Now that's a little bit harder, isn't it? Jesus is saying, this is how you pray, because he knows that life is going to get hard. Times are going to get hard. In real life, it's easy to become discouraged because we pray a lot. And if we're honest, we all have to admit that we have prayed prayers and we have not seen God answer them the way we want or in the timing that we want. And if we're really honest, sometimes it doesn't feel like he's answering or hearing our prayers at all. We battle with that discouragement. I remember somebody was telling me one time about a hard situation in their life, and they're going through this heart-wrenching time, and I did what every good-intentioned Christian, I said what every well-intentioned Christian said and should say. Well, just pray about it, you know. Of course they've been praying about it. And well, I'm going to pray for you. Well, of course I'm going to pray for you. But her response to me was amazing. It kind of took me back, because I said, well, we just need to keep praying about it. And she said this. She said, no, don't do that, because I don't want it to get worse. What a cynical outlook. You ever felt like that in your life? Another translation says it this way, to pray always and not lose heart. You ever gotten to a place in your life where you began to lose heart in your prayers? Where you began to wonder, is God listening? Many times when we pray, the clouds don't part. The earth doesn't break into joyous song. The mountains don't move. Sometimes the situation seems to get worse. The circumstances get more complicated. Our loved ones are not instantly healed. Our estranged spouse does not come back. Our children don't run back to the church and turn their lives around. Our bank account doesn't double overnight. The tension at work doesn't magically vanish. You know, is anybody here living real life with me? Sometimes it's really easy to lose heart and get discouraged when you pray. Jesus knew that. And that's why he wanted to show you, when life gets really hard, this is the way to pray. We pray with boldness, we pray while believing, and we pray with brokenness. He tells the story of a widow, and that's point number one, pray with boldness. This widow shows us the definition of boldness. The definition of bold is showing an ability to take risks, to be confident and courageous. And she was. This widow was bold and persistent. You have to understand, in her time, in the Palestinian court system, it was against the law for this woman to even approach a judge or enter into the courtroom. But she had no representative. She was in a desperate situation with no other option. And she needed the judge to grant her justice against her adversary. And she broke all the conventions of her day, and she broke the law, and she went to the court to plead her case. She had no one to represent her. She was all alone. You ever felt like that in your life? Now, she was dealing with a wicked judge who had no compassion, who did not fear God, and who did not respect people. Listen to me. This woman did not have an appointment. Her name wasn't on the docket, and she didn't know anybody in the clerk's office. And I can just see this woman day after day after day going and pleading. The situation was stacked up against her in every single way. But the one thing she did, she was bold and she was persistent. You say, Pastor Dave, that's two things. I don't agree. I think it's one thing. I think if you're going to be persistent, you're going to have to be bold. You're going to have to take a risk. You're going to have to display courage. Amen? Because it's easy to just lay down when life puts you on the floor. It's easy to stay down there, isn't it? It's easy to wallow. It's easy to say, oh, woe is me, and here I am again, and it will just never change. It takes boldness to get back up one more time and say, I'm going to keep on going. The court that Jesus is describing is not like a courtroom today that we have today. This was a tent that a regional judge would move from town to town in his district as he went. And they would go, they would set up the tent, and the judge would see whoever the judge wanted to see on that day. Many times there were bribes involved, and he would scratch the back of the important people. And this woman had none of that. And I can just see them setting up this tent in every single town. And every time they do, that old lady was sitting outside saying, Judge, will you hear me? Judge, will you hear me? Judge, will you hear me? I can see him telling her to be dismissed and telling the guards to put her away. And I can see her picking up rocks and throwing them at that tent. Can't you? Hey, you need to hear me. I need justice. Hey, you can't ignore me. And finally, after all that time, this judge says, even though I don't fear God and I don't care about people, I'm just going to give this woman what she wants so she will leave me alone. You can ask my kids. Persistence pays off, doesn't it? You ask dad long enough, please, 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 please. Eventually, he may say yes. She got the answer because of her boldness and her persistence. He says, I'm fine. I'm going to, just so she doesn't pester me, so I'm not worried to death by her constant persistence, so she doesn't wear me out by her persistent coming, he grants her request. When life gets real hard, and it doesn't seem like your prayers are going anywhere, you know what you have to do? You got to keep praying. You got to be bold. You got to get up the next day and say, the Lord said, the word of the Lord is, I will declare in the name of Jesus. You have to keep praying, and you have to be bold in your praying. And I want to remind every single believer in this room today, your situation is nothing like the situation of the widow. There is a contrast here. She was alone, but you and I have the constant and continual presence of God with us. She had no one to represent her, but you and I have an advocate with the Father. His name is Jesus, who is ever present and making intercession for us. We have a representative, and Jesus says, I got your back. She's dealing with a wicked judge who had no respect. We are praying to our loving Father who promises to hear us when we pray. She was a stranger talking to a stranger. You're a child of God talking to your Father God. We can boldly go before the throne of grace. Why? Because we're just going to see our dad. We're going to see our papa. I love my daughter Piper because Piper is bold. And I mean that in the sense of she's a risk taker, she's courageous, she's also bold. She got a great fashion sense from day one. She'd come out of the room with a blue, you know, Disney princess dress on, with pink slippers, with a purple slash, and she did her own makeup, and she's like, I'm ready to go. And Mama says, no, you're not. You ain't going out of the house like that. I remember one time she was making her Christmas list, and she had the American Girl catalog out, and there ain't nothing in that catalog under $100. I mean, that is just a money pit. And she's going through it, and we're watching her. I'm watching her in the kitchen, and she's on page one, and there's like three things on the top of the page and three things on the bottom of the page, and she takes her pen, and she circles everything on the page. I said, oh, Lord, help me. I go and I sit down. She turns to page two and she starts, and finally she just stops and she hops up from the kitchen and she runs into the living room and she hops into my lap and she says, Daddy, how do I spell all of it? I just want all of it. She was bold, and needless to say, in the days and months following that, she was also very, very persistent. But why did she have that? Why did she have that confidence? Why did she have that boldness? She had that because she was secure in my love for her. She knew that I loved her. She knew that I wanted to give her good things. And I think this, I think many of us, we're not secure in our prayers to God because we're insecure about our relationship with God. I think many of us, we're afraid to pray boldly. We're timid, and listen, the Bible says that you are fearfully and wonderfully made, that he loves you with an everlasting love. And the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 15 and 16, that we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tested in every way just like us, yet without sin. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness so that we can receive mercy and find grace to help us at the proper time. The Father loves you, the Son advocates for you, and the Spirit lives in you, and he helps you pray. You need to get secure in your relationship with God. Then you can get bold in your prayer. When life gets real hard, when the pressure builds and the situation turns for the worse, pray with boldness, pray with persistence, cry out day and night because God hears and God answers. I love this proverb. It says that the wicked run away when no one's chasing them, but the righteous are as bold as lions. Somebody in this house needs to get bold this morning. You need to get persistent. You need to say, I'm going to keep on keeping on. You need to pray with boldness. God honors bold prayers. Do you know why? Because bold prayers honor God. He can still do inconceivably and incomparably above and beyond anything that you can ask or think. You got to pray with boldness. Point number two, you got to pray while believing. Jesus asks this striking question at the end of his story in verse 8. He says, I tell you that he will swiftly grant them justice. And he's talking about God granting justice for the elect. But then he asks this question, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? What a question. Jesus is asking it. Will I find faith on the earth when I return? You know, there's only really two things that the New Testament says amazed Jesus. He was amazed at people's faith. You know what else he was amazed at? Their unbelief. Let me ask you, if he was going to be amazed at you this morning, which would it be because of? Your faith or your unbelief? I think this is a great question. I mean, God don't ever ask any bad questions. I mean, he's God. He's all-knowing. He's omniscient. But I think this is a really good question. Now, and I say that because the more I watch the news, the more I go to school board meetings, the more I spend time mixing and mingling at the county fair, which was a freak show last night. Y'all missed it. I think this is a you really didn't. I think this is a really good question. When Jesus comes back, will he find faith on the earth? It seems to me that faith is vanishing from our society and from our culture. Values are getting cheap. Morality is dying. Loyalty, fidelity, integrity. It's getting harder and harder to find these things. Everyone is lying about the truth and spinning whatever narrative fits their fancy of the week. Will he find faith on the earth? You know what? When he comes into this church and when he asks it this morning, you know what I want him to hear all of us say? You will find it in me, Lord. I don't care how hard it gets. I don't care how loud the opposition is. I don't care how long it takes. You'll find it in me. I'm praying and I'm believing. I believe this, that a world shadowed by doubt needs a church, a believing church, that will shine the light. A world that's shadowed with doubt, doesn't know up from down, has more questions than they got answers. A doubting world needs a church that's believing and that will shine the light. You just gotta believe. We love that. Whenever it gets down to the wire and we're watching a sports game and it seems like we have a possibility for the comeback, Micah always looks at me and he says, I'm saying, son, just turn this off and go to bed. There's no way they're going to win. He says, Dad, you gotta believe. You gotta believe. I'm saying, son, I've been watching this team a whole lot longer than you. I know what they do in the fourth quarter. Let's go to bed. Dad, you got to believe. A lot of us in our Christian walk, we've kind of gotten cynical like that. And we need a miracle. We need a breakthrough. We need to see God do something. And we think, well, I've seen how it's going to play out. It's just time to give up. Somebody in our life needs to look at us and say, you got to believe. You got to believe. Keep praying. This is what the Bible says in 1 John 5, 14 and 15. This is the confidence we have in approaching God. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we will have what we have asked of him. Notice the key there, according to his will. Not my will, Lord, but your will be done. But when we're praying in alignment with that, we know that he hears us and we know that we will have it. I'm here to tell you this morning, you don't need to be intimidated by prayer. Your prayer does not have to be fancy. You can offer it up to God on a paper plate and he will take it and eat it up. It don't have to be fancy, but it does have to be full of faith. Some of y'all know, most of y'all know, we adopted a son from India. And one of the best things about it, our favorite thing, has been teaching Ezra to pray, because Indian people, Hindu people, they're very religious. They meditate a lot. They pray a lot. And we're teaching him to pray to Jesus, praying in the name of Jesus. And we're teaching him these things. A few months ago, we went through a series of days, a pretty tough week, where Piper was in and out of the emergency room. We were in the emergency room all night, all day, for about 3 days in a row. And nobody knew what was wrong. We didn't know what was wrong. And I was exhausted. The kids were exhausted. The kids were worried. Piper was worried. Piper was in pain. And Ezra would FaceTime us in the hospital, and he'd say, oh, Piper, ouch, Piper, ouch. And she'd go, yeah, Piper, ouch, Piper, ouch. And one night when Micah and Laura and Madison were going to pray, Ezra tugged on Laura, and he said, Mommy, I pray. Mommy, I pray. And she said, okay, go ahead. And he folded his little hands. This is his first prayer by himself. And he said, Jesus, Piper, ouch, amen. Jesus, Piper, Ouch. Amen. I'm telling you, the prayer don't have to be fancy, but it does need to be in faith. All he knows is that we've taught him, when you pray in the name of Jesus, God answers. You know, Piper was home in 3 hours after 3 days of getting nowhere. 3 hours after that prayer. You know why? Because I believe Ezra prayed believing. I believe he prayed believing. I believe he prayed knowing that a God that he barely even knows would answer his prayer. Jesus, Piper, ouch, amen. Maybe you need to take the Piper out of that sentence and you just need to pray a simple prayer. Jesus, fill in the blank, ouch, amen. Keep believing and don't lose heart. Point number three, you got to pray with brokenness. Got to pray with brokenness. There's a contrast here between two very different men in verses 9 through 14. You have a Pharisee who is bold, and Jesus uses this parable because he wants to talk to the people who were trusting in their own righteousness and were looking down on everyone else. I know we have nobody in this room like that, but we'll just speak hypothetically this morning. These two men were totally different. One was very boastful and the other one was broken. One was showing off in prayer. The other one was sincerely asking for mercy. And the Pharisee wanted to be heard by men because he's boasting about all the things that he did and all the reasons why he was righteous. And I'm here to tell you the people around him may have heard him and they may have even been impressed, but his prayer was not heard by God because he was exalting himself. And God says, I hate the proud. Whoever exalts themselves, whoever toots their own horn, whoever shows why they deserve to be at the top and at the front of the line, whoever exalts themselves will be humbled. And if you refuse to humble yourself, the only way God will have to humble you is he will have to allow you to be humiliated. But whoever humbles themselves will be exalted. This tax collector was humble. He was broken. He wouldn't even look up and he just kept beating his chest. He was broken over his own sin. He cried out for mercy and Jesus received the prayer of the outcast. Do you know why? Because Jesus always receives the sinner. Jesus always receives the sinner. And until you experience brokenness over your own sin, you will never be able to be an agent of healing to a broken world full of broken people. It starts where all of us say, God, I am a sinner. It's not the problem with everyone else. It's not the problem with the politicians or with whoever. It's with me. I am a sinner. I need mercy. Lord, turn your wrath away from me, a sinner. That's a prayer God always answers. You know, you can never serve from an elevated position. You know what you have to do to serve? You got to get low. You got to get low. Look at the world around us. I look at what's happening in Afghanistan, Iraq, Africa. It breaks my heart. It breaks my heart. It should break all of us. And we should be praying with brokenness, praying, Lord, save them. Lord, deliver them. Lord, make a way. If you are here this morning and you're brokenhearted, there's some good news. Psalm 34:18 says this, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. You brokenhearted this morning, guess what? God ain't a million miles away. He's close. And he saves the ones who are crushed in spirit. Psalm 147:3 says that he heals the brokenhearted and he binds up their wounds. Psalm 51:17 says the sacrifice pleasing to God is a broken spirit, a broken and humbled heart. Oh God, you will not despise. Maybe instead of acting like you've got it all together, you need to pray for a little brokenness. We need to be bold and we need to believe. We also need to be broken. You know why? Because God takes the broken and he makes them bold believers. But if you try to exalt yourself, watch your next step. That's something my dad and my granddad always used to say to me when I would be walking around talking about, look what I did. Look at how great everything's going. Look at life. I mean, dad, everything is just going my way. He would always look at me. He'd say, son, you better watch your next step. I said, why? He says, because you know what comes before a fall? It's pride. Pride comes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. And before we close in prayer, I want you to remember something when you pray. I ask the worship team to come. Pray like Paul. The Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. He said, and pray for me also. Ask God to give me the right words so I can boldly explain God's mysterious plan that the good news is for the Jews and the Gentiles alike. I am in chains now, but I'm still preaching this message as God's ambassador. So pray that I will keep on speaking boldly for him as I should. Paul prayed for boldness to persist. Pray like Jesus, John 11:41. Jesus raised his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you hear me." He prayed believing, and he saw Lazarus raised from the dead. And pray like King David, who prayed with a brokenness. He said, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." He prayed with brokenness, and he was restored. I don't know how you need to pray this morning, but I know that we all do. I don't know how much you pray this morning, but I know that we need to pray more. And as we stand and we sing and we have this time of invitation, wherever you are and whatever you're going through, pray with boldness, pray believing, and pray with brokenness. You know, I don't know, and I'm just going to say it point blank. I don't know why bad things happen to good people. I mean, I have a theological answer. I understand sin in the world. Yeah, okay. That really doesn't do it for you when you're broken. Hello. I don't know why good things happen to good people. I don't know why innocent people die. I don't know why wars continue to rage, even though so many people pray for peace. I don't know. But you know this? I know that there is one prayer that God answers every single time, 100% of the time. Do you know what it is? "Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need you to save me." He answers that prayer every time. And if you've never prayed that prayer this morning, that needs to be where you start today. And if you've prayed a million times since then and a million hours since then, that's the prayer you need to go back to, because that's where it started. And he who began a good work in you isn't finished yet. Amen. Whether you need boldness or increase in faith or the power to believe, or you're going through a broken situation and you want to be restored, whatever you need to pray for, I'd love to pray with you. Let's stand together. Come if you need to come.
Call me out upon the waters, the great unknown. My feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in ocean. You are mine, oh.
That's the boldness. He is mine. I am his.
I am.
And he is mine.
And you are mine.
Amen. We're going to keep letting the Lord minister to people. Amen. I preached a prayer on the way to pray when real life gets real hard. But I'm here to tell you this morning, we need to celebrate some miracles that God has been doing. Amen. Chris and Melissa Lloyd, who dedicated their son today, about 3 or 4 months ago, we went to Marshall and Donna's house and we prayed over her. She had a large cancerous tumor in her body. And I was just told last week that tumor has shrunk. It is less than half the size that it was before. And her husband, Chris, he gave his heart to the Lord the beginning of this year during COVID, watching the live stream, and he's getting baptized in September. Now, come on, somebody. That's what happens when you humble yourself and you pray. And we've been praying for a special, special little girl, granddaughter of a friend of mine named Brian and Linda. Brian, will you come real quick? This is amazing. I want you to hear about what God has done in their granddaughter's life.
Real close. Hi. Brianna Joy is my granddaughter. She's a trisomy 18 baby, which is a little bit worse than Down syndrome. So at birth, they gave her 50-50% chance of being born alive. She's born alive. There's a 90% chance that she would not make it through her first month. She made it through her first month. 90% chance she wouldn't make it through her first year. She's still alive. September 6th will be her second birthday. Anytime she gets sick, it's bad. So about a month ago, she got a cold. She had to go to Children's Hospital. A week ago, this past Thursday, she was diagnosed with pneumonia, which is almost a death sentence for her. We prayed last Sunday. Sunday afternoon, they changed her medication. Today, the pneumonia is gone. She will be coming home.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Amen.
Thank you.
Come on, somebody. Y'all can give the Lord praise. I'm here to tell you, he's still in the miracle business. Amen. I'm here to tell you, he still holds the power of life in his hand. And I'm here to tell you, he's no respecter of persons. What he's done for Melissa and what he's done for Brian and Linda and their granddaughter, he can do for you. You got to keep praying with boldness. You got to keep believing. And you got to come to that place of brokenness where you lay it all out and you receive his love. Amen. Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for the miracle working power that you're using and moving in the lives of your people. I pray it will encourage those who haven't seen their miracle, who haven't seen a breakthrough, who are still struggling and dealing in the fight, Lord. We just pray you'll give them boldness and persistence and strength. But we pray for our brothers and sisters all over the world who are in harm right now, who are being hunted down. We pray that the Spirit of the Lord would surround them. We pray that your angels would surround them and cover them. We thank you, O Lord, for the victor's crown that they will receive. But we ask, O God, you will save and protect and deliver. We ask for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. God bless you. We hope you'll stay with us for Sunday school. Hello, my name's Dave, and I'm the pastor here at Antioch Baptist Church. I just want to thank you for joining us for this time of praise and worship. I hope that it impacted your life and that it inspired you to take your relationship with God to the next level. If you were watching today and you felt convicted by the Lord to accept Christ as Savior and Lord of your life, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Just say, "Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need you to make me new. I invite you into my life to be my Lord and to be my master. I believe that you rose from the dead, and I believe that you are the Son of God, and I believe that you will return to the earth again to take me home to be with you. Jesus, thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying for my sin. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. Amen." If you prayed that prayer and if you responded to that message today, we'd love to hear about it. I want you to contact us here at the church and let us know about the impact that it's had on your life so that we can celebrate with you and so that we can give you some resources to help you in furthering your walk with Jesus. Thank you so much for tuning in. God bless you. And remember to love, connect, go, and grow.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to feel